Start the recording. Wonderful. So, good evening, everyone. We will spend maybe today's session, or perhaps today plus a little bit of the Saturday session as well on VBA. It's important to understand the background, right? Not just go head first into it and start learning it. Just like I've done with Power BI and Excel, it is important in VBA as well. I would say that with Excel and Power BI, I gave you the background so that you guys have a holistic idea, even though it is not required. I mean, you have to learn it. So I don't really have to sell you too much. With VBA, it is trickier, right? Because what happens is that there are different programming languages and, you know, we only have so much time in a day. And we ask ourselves, should we learn it? Is it used? And some person will randomly walk up to you and say that, no, VBA is an old language and it is not supported, and why do you want to work on it? So there are a lot of different signals that you would get from different people. Like I'll give you proof, okay? I don't like to give opinions, I like to give proof. So I had a call with Tata Communications today with the global legal team. And so there's a techno commercial guy called Amol Savant with whom I'm working. So, you know, so we were discussing their requirements. So they basically have an internal software called Serengeti. They have some invoice copies and summaries and an Excel summary that come in. Then they do a batch processing, combine it into a folder. And basically they want to automate this entire process. So it is taking them a certain X number of hours to do it. They have two teams for India and for US. Most of their core team sits in the US. And, you know, so it takes X number of hours. Plus there are lots of small issues that happen, errors and inefficiencies. So we were figuring out how to do it. Now I will tell you what a conversation typically looks like. The first thing that we have to do before writing the code, you know, is to understand, of course, it's a hybrid method, right? So it's not that we are using only VBA or only Excel or only Power BI, using a combination of different things. So Microsoft has something called Power Automate. If you haven't read about this, please do. This is going to be very important going forward. So there is an entire universe that Microsoft is creating called Power Apps. You know, like you have Power Pivot, Power Query, Power Maps, Power BI, Power Automate. This was called Microsoft Flow earlier. So it's basically an RPA platform, right? And for business process automation, BPA. And how it looks is, essentially, there are different connectors and you can define a workflow. It's workflow automation. So if you notice, these are different services that I have. These are all Microsoft services. So I'll just give you a simple example. Let us say there is a tweet that is posted for my company, right? Let's say Havisham. I am not on Twitter, but let's just say that for Havisham Consulting, there is a tweet that gets posted tagging me. What will happen? I will check if the user has more than 100 followers. I will create a new record, all right, in Dynamics, which is their CRM, that's the logo. And I will add that person as a member to my list on MailChimp. This is how a workflow looks like. And you can, of course, add different steps. The idea here is that you're able to connect multiple providers, business productivity tools, and make a workflow automation. A typical workflow automation would mean that if I receive an email in Outlook from, let's say, 5 designated email IDs, where the attachment, there are at least 3 attachments, and each attachment is at least 50 KB and above. I want to automatically put it on SharePoint. I want to send an acknowledgement to my manager saying that it has been put. And maybe in Microsoft Excel Online, an entry is created saying that on so-and-so date, this file was automatically saved in your SharePoint folder. Pretty cool, right? Like, in bits and pieces, this has been around for many years, but now is when technology is really catching up. And at large, we are able to use all this, you know, because you have AI tools and the cloud has become cheap enough for everybody to be able to use it. Now, there is another company called Zapier, which is one of the leading providers in the world for workflow automation. And basically what they do is, give you a few examples. Let's just pick one, okay? Let's say Google Sheets.
Yeah, I've
Let
heard of it. They help in lead generation and
Right.
replying to their customers
Absolutely.
automated
And not
one.
just that, I mean, Zapier is, you should definitely go to the website and explore. Fantastic work. So the basic idea is that, let's say, an entry comes on Google Sheets, like somebody fills up a survey, it comes on Google Sheet, an automated email is sent to you and maybe to your manager with certain records from it. Now, see, the problem is that there are so many business productivity apps in the world and different companies. So integration is also dependent on whether they want to open themselves up to other people, right? So whether APIs are allowed or not. So I will not get into details here, but you guys can go. They sell by a very interesting model called Zaps. What that means is that you don't have to pay a fixed cost. You pay as per the number of tasks per month, right? So let's say I have 50 customers and I'm reaching out to my customers 5 times a month. So that basically means I'm reaching out 250 times. So this is what they have. They have something called Zaps, right? Which is every occurrence of a transaction. Now, the thing is that there are proper RPA tools which work at a system level. For example, you have, let's say, Automation Anywhere, right? Incidentally started by an Indian, Mihir Shukla. Now, don't get too disappointed with the number. Remember, RPA is still a growing area and we expect it to grow with time. But the, and of course, this number is not even correct. The point is that RPA is not just something where these software RPA companies are working. All the big giants are interested in it. Like if you notice, IBM is very gung-ho on it. Microsoft is very gung-ho on it, right? Because RPA is expected to become a very important part of every business process, which basically means that if something can be automated, they want to automate it. Anything, you know? The simple task of opening the system in the morning, going to SAP, downloading a file, making a pivot, sending it to the manager. We can automate all of this, right? So this is me giving you a broader perspective where I'm automating the entire business process. VBA is about spreadsheet modeling. Sorry, about spreadsheet processes, right? Not modeling, spreadsheet processes where you're automating a spreadsheet. Automation Anywhere, Blue Prism, UiPath, all of these work at a system level. Like you can do web scraping and screen scraping and all of that. Like all of you who are engineers would know this, but for the benefit of others, how scraping works is the same thing it used to happen 10, 15 years back. It's screen testing, right? For example, let's say I have to fill up a form, right? So what will I do? The system automatically has to come to the search bar, put in a query, click on enter, right? Now, how is that going to happen? Now, this is all HTML and JavaScript. So if I, please watch, if I right click on Google and I say inspect, right? Now, this is a picture, which is fair enough. But let me show you this part where it says the search box is there, right? So I have this logo and then I have this search box. Let's say there is Gmail written here. So if I click on that, it now shows me that Gmail part. Now, obviously, if you notice, there is a link that is coming here. So when I click on Gmail, it will be redirected to my Gmail. All right. But let's say I go to havishamconsulting.com and I simply take this part of Gmail and I sort of edit it. Right. So I'm just going to take this AHREF part. I'm sure this much of HTML, all of you remember, we have all studied this in school. So the basic idea is that now when I click on Gmail, it will basically direct me to my website. The idea here is that this is how testing happens, right? So on a website, the entire website is open. Like you can do whatever you want to do with it. For example, if you go to Harvard Business Review and you want to see something about the website, you know, their websites are very cool. I mean, lots of nice design elements and things like that. What you will be able to do is, let me just. And Harvard Business Review also has an Easter egg, right? Which is very fun. Watch. When I click on inspect, do you notice the top of the page? It actually says Harvard Business Review as a comment, which the programmer must have written, right? But anyway, the point here is that everything that you see is something that you can inspect, and that is how web scraping also happens. Now, imagine this also works at a software level. For example, let's say I'm working with, what software should I show you? Just give me a moment. Okay, let's say the custom UI editor, right? So let's say there's a software like this that I'm working on. Now, if I have to repeatedly do a task where I have to click on file, open a file, make a change, save it, why can't the system do it? And that is how testing has always happened, right? Form testing, user form testing. Now, RPA is primarily meant for things like these, you know, system-wide applications at a very large scale. So you're looking at thousands and lakhs of transactions. BPM companies like TCS and Wipro and all of that, for a lot of years, people have been asking, will you start firing people? Because, you know, once RPA starts to become large, you will not need so many people. It's not true entirely, even though they have been saying, no, we'll keep on hiring more people. The fact of the matter is the entire purpose of putting in RPA is to reduce the manpower cost, is to reduce the manpower errors that happen. The future is going to be RPA. There's no question about it. It might take time. And there's a lot of different schools of thought on it. Like I, for one, feel RPA, the biggest problem is that when you do automation, we don't even bother to fix the internal SOP. If you don't, it's like putting a band-aid, right? If you put a band-aid without fixing the wound, without fixing the incorrect SOP in the business, it works and it will continue to work as long as you have a fresh band-aid. But the point is you never bother to fix it in the first place, right? So from an enterprise execution, like what I do with different companies, there is always a discussion about how much to automate. You know, it's a trade-off. We are deadlines. There's a scope of work. There are many tasks that we have to perform. And also the fact that certain things probably should not be automated. A manual intervention is good, or at least some checks are good. All of this seems very simple when you put it like that. You know, but when you have a moving system with multiple paths in it and many stakeholders in it, then you have cross-functional discussions. IT has a say. Data security now has become so important. So these are very interesting conversations, and probably you can just Google a little bit about it just to see how all of these work, right? So that's the broad background of automation as an entire entity. Let's funnel down to Excel now, all right? Now we know what Visual Basic is, but there is always a confusion about what is Visual Basic and what is macros. Now see, macros is the term, you know? So a macro basically means that it's a rule or a pattern that specifies an input sequence where you have a output sequence as per a defined procedure, all right? A macro is not related to Excel. A macro is related to any programming language. So if you notice, I can have macros in Python. I can have macros in JavaScript. I can have macros in, let's say C#, whatever it is. So this is the first learning for all of you. Macros is a computing term which doesn't really refer to Excel per se. What happens is that Excel users interchangeably use it. They say, I wrote a macro, I wrote a VBA script. But you should know that a VBA code is not the same as a macro. A macro is a generic term, and a VBA is the macro that you do on Excel files, all right? Now, Visual Basic for applications, right, is different from VB. So VB, I'm sure, even if you haven't worked on it, like I haven't worked on it, but all of you would have heard of it. So Visual Basic is a very old language. And then VBA was a slightly modified version of Visual Basic that was embedded inside Office documents. What does that mean? Let's say I want to work on JavaScript or HTML, whatever it is. So I use something called Atom. Now, Atom is my IDE, which is my interactive development environment where I can do development work. Like this, you have Visual Studio as well. Again, I'm sure all of you, most of you would be engineers, so at some point you would have seen this. So you have Visual Studio Code and you have Visual Studio, which is an integrated development environment, right? So just to make sure that all of us are on the same page, we're looking at an integrated development environment, which is nothing, it's just a software application which allows a computer programmer to do software development. Simple, right? Now, VBA was different because it was embedded inside an office document. That means that where do I write my code? I write it directly inside Excel or Word or PowerPoint or Outlook, all right? So I don't need to have something else. Obviously, it's very similar to VBA. So a VBA coder would, programmer would know how to do VBA and vice versa, even though there are some differences. Now, if you look at VBA, you would see that in 2008, it was declared as a legacy language, which basically said that Microsoft said, we're not going to support it anymore. Because VBA is not the future. It has so many inherent limitations in it. See, VBA is not like C and C sharp and all, which is still used, like application development still happens on C++ or C sharp. But it's not like C++, okay? So VBA is, again, an event-driven programming language. And the basic idea is that in 2008, Microsoft was not interested in it anymore, okay? Now, Microsoft is working on something called TypeScript. TypeScript is basically JavaScript, a slightly modified version. So it's a programming language maintained and developed by Microsoft. And it's nothing, it's just a slightly strict superset of JavaScript. All of it doesn't mean much right now. It's the only takeaway for you today should be the fact that, there is something called TypeScript, and TypeScript is really taking over. A lot of Python developers are also learning TypeScript now. So TypeScript can be transcompiled into JavaScript. That basically means that you can, whatever you do on TypeScript, you can use it on JavaScript as well. Okay, now, if you notice, this is very new. So it first appeared in 2012, and this is what Microsoft is moving towards. The question is why? Why did they choose it? Now, if you Google things like the future of Excel VBA, you have these very large, old, experienced developers around the world. There's a very large community of Excel developers, right? And there was a very nice article called Will VBA Die in 2019? And I'll just share the link with you. Just put it on the chat window. So it's a short read, just about 15 minutes or so, right? Not even that. So it came in 2019 May. And anyway, let's ignore all of this. Let's look at the last part. When will VBA die? Now, here's the short answer. In my opinion, it will never fully go away, which basically means that at least for the next 15 years, people are going to use it extensively. See, languages never die. No language will ever be dead. I know of companies that still use COBOL and I'm not kidding you, okay? When we say that a client doesn't have a new version of Excel, I can give you instances of clients working on God knows what all. I have people working on Lotus 1-2-3 and Fortran and all that. It happens with older companies. Now, the thing is that so many companies rely on VBA for process automation, especially the management, the professional services firm, KPMG, Deloitte, EY and PwC, right? And too many Excel users have invested time in learning VBA that they will not really shift to something else immediately, right? And again, if you keep on scrolling, you will see that at least for the next 10, 15 years, I think it's going to be there. But why are they pushing JavaScript now? Microsoft is pushing JavaScript for a very simple reason. Everybody wants to move to the cloud, correct? One of the big benefits of using Google Sheet was that Microsoft Excel was never good with the cloud, but now it is. Now, if I show you, I know it's a lot of information I'm giving you, but I would definitely want you all to watch this 40 minutes again. Just at least one more time and take down some notes. This will help you for the rest of your career, right? So let me open a Excel workbook online. Now, do you see this, everyone? I have something called Script Lab, and within this, I have something called Code. Let me just refresh the page once. What is all this? This is what TypeScript is, right? Now, this is the advantage. What I'm showing you right now on online is the same thing that will work on my local system. It will work on iPads and different devices and servers and all of that. And you notice there's something called Automate. Automate is the web version of VBA, because VBA never worked on the web. Please remember that. Even though Excel Online has been there for many years, not just a year old, VBA was never built as a web-friendly language. VBA predates the web. VBA has been around since 1985, right? So obviously it predates the web, and it never, they never improved it to accommodate the web because it never could. If you notice now, let me give you a small example, everyone. Let me increase the size first. Please watch, very simple example. I have 1, 2, 3, right? I'm going to click on record actions. So what am I doing? It's recording whatever I'm doing right now. So let's say I select the three cells. I press Control B for bold. Do you see what happens? It says bold A1 colon E3, right? Then I come and I say equal to sum of these three numbers. And I also want to change the color to green. So it says edit A4. And then it says set background color to whatever color we have chosen. Okay, now let me stop it. Now, needless to say, this will get saved as a script, correct? All right, and obviously, if I want to rerun it, all I have to do is I have to click on run, and you notice it runs the script, and whatever tasks I performed earlier, whatever operations I performed, the same operation will get executed once again. This is all instantaneous, but my connection is a little slow because I'm on a call with you guys, right? But otherwise, it should be instantaneous. Anyway, that's, you get the idea, right? Now, if I click on edit, you will notice that this is how the code looks. Let me just copy it and put it on a different application so that you can see this clearly. Now remember, in language, I've actually selected, I don't know if TypeScript is there or not. Yeah, so I've selected JavaScript, right? So you can see this is basically a JavaScript code. Function main, workbook, Excel script dot workbook, right? And then of course you have your curly brackets here and here. It makes sense, right? This is a comment like this. What are we doing? We are first selecting the sheet, which is my selected sheet variable, which is workbook.getActiveWorksheet. Then in A1, A3, I'm taking the format, font, bold is true. Then I basically set my formula, which is equal to sum of A1, A3. And then I set the fill color, which is this. Now, this is going to be a game changer because even now, like the call I had with Tata today, it is all about manual work. You know, there are these trained professionals with years of experience, finance managers and FPA heads and chartered accountants, and who all have to do the work manually. They have been doing it for many, many years because the software was never able to automate their processes. And we all learn to work that way. We never even felt that there's a better way of doing things. But now technology has enabled me to be able to automate all of these things, right? Let's take a small pause here. Any questions, anyone? Anyone?
This recording thing is not there in Excel, right?
Yeah, so how that happens is that right now the automate is not there on Excel, and we don't know whether it will come or not. We do have a record, but the recording happens on VBA as we speak, right?
So like what I know, we have to write macro codes, or do we have any easier way to?
No, you can do a record on VBA also. See, we will come to it, but just a quick glimpse. See, when you're working on Excel, do you see this button at the bottom, everyone, in the bottom left corner?
Yeah.
Do you see the small button that says, no macros are currently recording, click to begin recording a new macro. This has always been there. This is nothing new. This has been there for 15, 20, 25 years, right? Which is the record button. When I click on this, it basically starts my recording. This is actually the daddy, right? And this is all the new, these are the new kids on the block, right? What you see here. Should you start learning it right now? I think yes. Not learn it extensively, because these are so new that even me, like, you know, I have 15 years of experience in Excel. Even we have just started doing all of this work. Now, There is a very nice video I would like you to watch called by Bill Jelen, which is on TypeScript. Bill Jelen, everyone, is basically called Mr. Excel. His YouTube channel is Mr. Excel. He has been working with Microsoft for over 35 years now. He was there when they launched Excel, right? So that's how experienced he is. And he's literally the number one defining authority on Excel in the world. So he runs his own consulting firm, but he acts like a consultant to Microsoft. Like Microsoft asks him before they launch a feature. That's how good he is, right? Now, if you notice in February 2020, this year, he came up with a video saying Excel VBA killer, TypeScript debuts in Excel. And just look what he wrote. This is very insightful. He said, for 16 years, people asked me if Excel VBA will be around forever. And he always said, don't worry, they can't kill it unless there is a viable replacement with a macro recorder. And today in public preview, Office Scripts offer a macro recorder that records TypeScript. This will be the product that will eventually kill Excel VBA. Listeners deal with stages of grief as I try to figure out if I could figure out TypeScript. The reason I wanted all of you to read it, and I wanted to make you read it, is to help you understand that this year, 2020, is a huge shift in the way Excel is going to perform. With dynamic arrays, which we did, remember, unique and filter and all of that, that's a big game changer. And also, Power Query, of course, has been there for a while in Power Pivot, but dynamic arrays is a very under the hood change. It's not very prominent, but very important. And this, TypeScript. And because I did not want you to just take my opinion on it, that's why I wanted you to read it, right? So please definitely watch this video. It's a short video, whatever, some 5-10 minutes, and he explains what it is and how it works, right? And you know, if you follow him on LinkedIn, he will say the same thing. He said, I don't like it. I don't like the fact that I have to learn something from scratch. But then he says that that's the fun part. You know, it's like he feels like a kid having to learn something again. That's how all of us feel. So you guys are not behind the curve, all right? If you're feeling, oh my God, there is so much and you guys already have a head start. How will we learn all this? Guys, TypeScript is as new to us as it is to you. Maybe I have a couple of months of head start, but that's about it. Now, today, if you say, no, these things will take many, many years to become a part of organizations. Believe me, 2-3 years back when I used to think to myself, you know, will there ever be a day when Power BI and Power Query and Power Pivot organization will start to work on it? And, you know, I used to tell myself, no, these companies will never grow and they will never upskill and they will never work. Today, I see the change happening. Shifts happen. It doesn't happen instantaneously. It's not that the day something launches, organizations want to learn it. But in a 18, 24 month, 36 month time period, you see that organizations slowly start to adopt it and get adapted to it. So there are all these early adopters. Like an early adopter would be, it can be any company. Usually the late adopters are people like PwC and EY. The reason is management consulting firms. You know why? Their systems are so well-defined. Their processes are so well-defined. There's always a trade-off. When you define your process very well, there is also a rigidity in it, right? And it's very difficult because you have trained people so well to follow certain guidelines. When something new comes in, it's very difficult for people to leave it and do something different. They are not very nimble, right? They're very rigid. They're very set in their ways. That's why they have brand guidelines and brand philosophies and all of that. So I'm just giving you a perspective, but like today, Power BI, all of you would agree that companies are using it. I don't have to sell you too much on it. Trust me, even as recent as a year and a half back, early 2019 and all, I used to go to companies and they were like, no, Havish, Power BI and all is okay, it's great, but we never see ourselves using it. Look at it today. I mean, I'm handling entire projects on it and organizations say, no, we don't want to work on Excel anymore. We want to work on Power BI. So learn for the future. Learn for the next 5-10 years. Don't just learn for what you need today, all right? TypeScript is the future. That said, are we going to learn TypeScript? No, we're not going to learn it. One is because it's so new that there isn't any official proper, I mean, there is documentation available, but there aren't a lot of use cases. You know, like people like me, if I want to show you what I've done on VBA, I have hundreds of case studies and projects that I've completed. And if you go to Stack Overflow, you'll find thousands, not even hundreds, you'll find thousands of projects. TypeScript, you will not find a lot because it's so new. People are still figuring it out and learning it. And Microsoft is still polishing it, right? So it's still not a finished product, all right? So this is how I wanted to start, which is to give you guys an understanding of the fact that VBA will be there always, but TypeScript is where they're moving towards. But VBA will still be supported. They're not going to suddenly cut off VBA one day. It's impossible. It's not even improbable, it's completely impossible. This is for the future. So this should be 10-15% priority for you. 85% priority should be on Excel VBA. If you are in finance, then VBA becomes very important for you. If you're in HR, moderate importance. If you're in marketing, personally, I feel you can probably skip it. And there are reasons for it. From my experience, marketing, the sort of data points that you have to handle and the dump that you get and the visualization you have to create, VBA has very little role to play there. VBA is wherever there is repeatable tasks, which is HR and finance. Marketing is not repeatable task. There is a little bit here and there, but marketing and sales is, you know, more about the execution rather than the actual repeatable tasks. Great. So now that we have a very good understanding of the background of VBA, we are going to, let me create a new file so that there's no confusion, all right? VBA is there in every version of Excel. So 2007, 10, 13, 16, 19, Microsoft 365. So you don't have to worry about it that, oh, do I have the latest version or not? No problem, it will work. There have been some changes, like if you're working on 2003 Office or 2007, one or two codes might not work, right? Also, you have to be aware of the version, 32-bit or 64-bit. Certain codes in VBA do not work on 32-bit systems if you have written it in 64-bit, right? So let me just give you a perspective. So VBA 32 versus 64 compatibility. See, it says that your Excel 2016 program runs perfect on 2016, but fails on Excel 2007 or a 64-bit Excel 2013. So this is something very common, and unfortunately, you have to get into hardcore programming here. Like this is what we call a PTR safe qualifier, which basically means that we are declaring that even if you're working on an older version, it should support it. But life is not that simple. Some cases it will still not work, and it's on a case-to-case basis, right? So you have to figure out what the problem is, even though for you guys it will not be a problem, you know, because all of you guys will be working on only 64-bit. I had a challenge because till about 3-4 years back, a lot of companies were still working on 32-bit. But as we are moving along, I think there are very few companies that still work on 32-bit systems, right? So it shouldn't really be a problem. But I want to share with you the complexity of working as a programmer. You know, it's not just that I have to spend time writing the code. Most of my time goes into reading documentation and going to forums and asking questions and all of that. I think let's jump straight into it. Now that we've seen the background, let's start writing a VBA code. The Excel file will be saved not as an Excel file, but as a save as on my desktop. Let me call this day 06. Not the first option, which is Excel SX. It will be the second option, which is macro enabled workbook. This is a file that supports VBA codes. There are two file extensions that support VBA. One is macro enabled workbook, which is Excel SM, and the other is binary workbook, which is Excel SB. Binary workbook, let's not get into it right now, but this is 99% what you will be using. Macro enabled workbook. Let me save it. The first thing you will notice is that even the, do you see this? This is my normal Excel. This is my macro enabled. Do you notice that exclamation mark? That is what tells the user that this is a special type of a file. This is not a regular Excel file. Okay. Other than the fact that this will support VBA codes, I can do whatever I can do on a normal Excel file. There is no other difference, right? To be able to write a VBA code, we have to enable the developer tab. It is called the developer tab because this is development work, right? And Microsoft knows that a normal user, even an advanced user, will never need to work on development. That is why this tab has been hidden by the user. So File, Options, I click on Customize Ribbon, and if you notice, there is a Developer tab and I have to enable it like this. This is only a one-time thing that you have to do. And you only have to do it with one Excel. If you do it with one Excel, it's a system-wide setting, so it gets enabled on all the Excel files. Should you disable it after you use it? You don't need to. Like, as long as it doesn't bother you, that's okay. You can keep it enabled, but the first time you will have to enable it. Now, do remember that you will have to enable it separately for Word, PowerPoint, Outlook, and Excel. Now, even though VBA works on all these applications, out of every 1,000 codes available or that people write, 999 are on Excel. Only one would be on the other three applications. So even though we can do automation on PowerPoint, Word, and Outlook, it doesn't really make any much sense to do automation on those applications. Excel is where you want to do automation, right? So if somebody says, can you do VBA on other Office applications? Yes, you can. Do people do it? Very rarely, like very, very rarely, like 1 in 1,000 ratio. Once we have the developer tab, we want to select Visual Basic, which is this one. Visual Basic will basically open up another window. Remember when we clicked on Power Pivot and Manage, I told you that a new window will open up, which is Power Pivot. If you notice, both of these can open at the same time, Excel and Power Pivot. Same thing. When we went to Data and we selected Power Query Editor, you notice that we had the Power Query window, but there is a small difference. When a Power Query window is open, I can't select my Excel file. I can only work on Power Query. Once I save and close it, only then I can work on Excel. When I click on VBA, you notice that a new window like this opens up. This is not how it looks. Just a minute. This is how it looks, okay? I can concurrently work on VBA and Excel at the same time just by pressing Alt Tab like this, right? Now let's understand what all is happening here. This is your integrated environment where you're going to write the code. Now, on the left, this entire rectangle is your Project Explorer. This tells you how many Excel files are open on your computer right now. So which file are we working on? Day 06, which is Day 06 XLSM. And in that file, what all objects do we have? We have a workbook and we have a worksheet, correct? So one is the workbook, and within the workbook, we have a sheet called Sheet 1. These XLAMs are something different. XLAMs are basically add-ins, like my statistical tool pack and all. We'll come to it later. Now imagine I open another Excel file. So now what will happen? On the VBA window, you will see that. You see this? There is a book 2 and there is a day 6. So I can see two Excel files. The VB window is not separate for different Excels. There is only one common VB window where I can see all the Excel files at the same time. So let me close that. Book 2. But where do we write the code? We have the sheet and we have the workbook, but we want to write the code in a place which is called a module. So I will right click and say Insert Module. And now this area that you see, everyone, there are three objects we have. We have the workbook, we have the sheet, and we have the module, correct? How many workbooks can we have? Only one. One file will only have one workbook. One file can have multiple sheets, and one file can have multiple modules in it. So let me write something. I want to write a very simple code that will tell me what is the name of the person whose laptop we are working on. Fair enough? But how do you do that? Because this is a system setting. You can't see this on Excel, right? You can't just write a formula to see who is working on the system. But because I'm working on VBA, I have access to many more things, right? So we have something called an object library. This is the small button here, this one. The object browser, F2. Now, if you notice, these are all the objects that are supported in Excel VBA. Let's see what all we have. We have calculate item, we have auto filter, we have areas, we have author, we have color. And like this, there are hundreds of these available, right? And then each one will have different methods here, right? So we're not getting into the absolute granular detail, but these are basically different classes I have. And then you have different functions and methods inside it. Okay, let me close this. So what do we want? We want to write a code. A code is called a subroutine. So let me hop over back to Google and show you what a subroutine is. Again, it's a computing term. Just like we have a macro, a subroutine is a sequence of instructions that perform a task, and they are packaged as a unit. That means I'm writing one subroutine, and when I call it, when I execute or run it, it will perform a series of tasks for me, a series of instructions for me, right? And of course, subroutine is there on every programming language. How do you write a subroutine on VBA? We write sub.
Isn't subroutine same as macro? Because macro also does the same. If you record it and then you save it, and then it performs a set of instructions.
Usually when we refer to a macro, it basically refers to us recording something, right? Where we are recording an action or a series of steps and we are repeating it, we are replaying it. But a subroutine usually is not recorded. It is something that is typed by you, right? That's the difference. I mean, I know it's similar, but a macro is more of, how should I put it? A macro is more about repeating the same task over and over again, right? A specific pattern that you want to apply again and again. A subroutine is more of a programming instruction. It is not about repeatability necessarily. I can also write a subroutine to repeat something, but it is not necessary that my subroutine is meant to repeat something. A macro, on the other hand, is used only when you want to repeat something over and over again. Right? So that would be the difference. See, again, this is not computer science 101. Neither do I want to get into that area, nor am I qualified to answer that question with absolute ease and finesse. I can only share with you. See, I'm a non-engineer, non-programmer. I have only been working on programming for the last 5 years. It's a different matter that last year I was a 40 under 40, which was a Global Innovators Award for my work done in VBA. I was the only person on the list who was in VBA. All the others were in AI and ML and all of that. The ex-Amazon Alexa head was in the same list as me. So that is to say that I do some groundbreaking work on VBA. That goes without saying. But at the same time, if you like point a finger strictly at my computer background, I don't come from a computer background, right? So you have to understand that. So hence I'm answering you to the best of my capability, but I don't want to tell you that, no, this is what I'm saying, you have to believe it, because I might still not know the entire background. You know, I might not be able to explain very well. I might know it, I might not be able to explain it very well. All right, so we want to write a subroutine. So we write SUB and we want to give it a name. So I will say system name, whatever name you want to give. The moment you press enter, a few things will happen. Number one, you notice the SUB has become in blue color. I don't know if you can see it, but it is blue in color. And the S has also become capital. The second thing is you get an opening and closing parentheses. This happens on its own. And the third thing is you get an end of subroutine. Whatever we want to execute can be written below inside this, the opening and the closing tag. So I want to say, this is my code I want to execute. So this obviously is a comment in green color. A single apostrophe is how you write a comment on VB. Like in, you will, let's say, use a hash in Python. Similarly, you use a apostrophe. In TypeScript, you use a double slash, right? Same in Power Query also, right? Then you will have something like this if you're working on XML, right? So different languages have different ways of putting a comment. What do we want? we want to show the system name, the username, right? So I just say message box, MSG box. Now, the moment I open a parenthesis, you notice that it looks like it's a function, right? It's an inbuilt function. So there are different arguments or parameters in it. There are certain mandatory parameters like the prompt, and there are some optional parameters like the button style and title and all of that. So what do we want to say? We want to say that the system belongs to, okay, so far so good. But then I also want to show the system, the username, but let's see if this works or not. Again, you notice M is capital and B is capital. So it has autocorrect, which most of the languages have, which means that you do have to follow the case. So there is a case sensitivity, but it will autocorrect it for you, right? So even if you write it like this, for some reason, when you go to the next line, it will automatically fix it. It also has IntelliSense, which is IntelliSense is basically code completion. Like when I write something, let me just show you how that looks so that you can see how it looks on a different platform as well, right? Let's say when I work on R, right? So if I say IN, let me just zoom in everyone. If I say install, what happens? It completes the code for me, correct? So I can say install.packages and it completes the code for me. Now this is there on nearly every IDE and every language has this. And the same thing is thankfully also there on VBA. If you notice when I write MSG, it doesn't actually complete it automatically, but we have to press Control plus spacebar, right? So please watch. If I say MSG and I press Control spacebar, it will automatically make it message box like this, right? Okay, let's see if it is working or not. How do I run it? I can either run it by clicking on this run button, which is F5, but what's the point? Why do I want to run it from here? I want the user to run it, correct? So we close the window. And in developer, we have macros, right? So do you see how even on Microsoft Excel, they use it interchangeably? Like we wrote a subroutine, but it has been categorized under macros, right? There is something called system name. How do I run it? I click on run and it basically opens a message box saying the system belongs to, right? Let's go back. But I also want to show the username. So I will write and application dot. Now this is the IntelliSense that I told you. The moment I put a dot, it tells me all the members that are there, right? So I can type username. Let's see what happens now. Let me run it again. This time it says the system belongs to Harish Madhupati. But I want to see this in different lines. Like the first line should be the system belongs to, the second should be Harish Madhupati. Now in Excel, how do I do it on Excel, anyone? Can anybody tell me if I want to put Harish Madhupati on a different line, how do I do that? What do we press?
Alt Enter.
Right, absolutely. So we do, just a minute. So we do an alt enter, right, everyone, which is basically a line break. But how do you create the line break inside a code, right? Like when you're working on Excel, you can just press alt enter, but how do you do that inside a code? So what I'll do is
slash n.
Yeah, so good try. So most of the time you should be able to use your slash n, but it doesn't work like that here. You write vb new line. But it makes sense, doesn't it? Like, even if you haven't seen this ever, you look at it and it makes sense, you know? You're basically writing a text, which is this. You're putting a new line and then you're writing the username. Let's see how it looks now. Come back, we'll run it, and you get a new line like this. If you want two lines, then you can just copy it once more. and I get two lines there, right? Great. Any question on this so far?
So when we are writing application.username, it is basically taking the application means the system only.
Application is basically the application of working on Excel, Microsoft Excel.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, now this is to give you an idea of how you enable developer, what is VBA and how do you write a code. Now let's look at something practical. Let's take an example. I have, just give me a moment. I just got an email. Just 1 minute. One second, guys. All right. So on Excel, if I make many sheets, let's say 5 sheets, can I hide all the sheets at the same time? No, can I hide all the sheets? Yes or no? Quick. Yes or no?
Together, I'm not sure.
Even one at a time. Can you hide all the sheets? No, you can't. At least one has to be visible. Okay. Now I can hide multiple sheets at the same time like this. But if I try to hide the last one, it says it has to have one visible worksheet, which is something I'm okay with. My question is, if I want to unhide all the 4 sheets that I've hidden, can you unhide all of these in one go? Like I hid 4 at once, right? But can you unhide 4 at the same time? You can't, right? If you notice, I will have to go one by one and say sheet 5, okay. Then I'll again say right click, unhide sheet 3, okay, like this. And people say, but why? I mean, if I can hide multiple, why doesn't Excel give me an option to basically select all? Like you can't do control A inside this box. You can only do it one by one. This is a classic example of where a macro can help us, right? We are basically trying to do something that Excel can't do. Now, Excel hasn't been built to hide multiple sheets, to unhide multiple sheets. What I can do is I can create a repeatable task. That means I will create a macro that will unhide all the sheets one by one. But to me as the user, it will happen instantaneously. Fair enough. Let's see how we do it. We can have multiple subroutines in a single module. So when you write another sub, let's say unhide my sheets, you notice there is a line that comes, a separator line. You can have as many subroutines as you want in one module. You can even make multiple modules. So that's up to you how you want to set up your system. And what do we want to do here? See, the first thing I want is to count how many sheets I have, correct? Then I want to run a loop which will go through all the sheets one by one. So let's say there are 5 sheets. So if you go to the first one, it will make it visible. It will go to the second one, it will make it visible. Go to the third one, make it visible. And it will keep on doing it till it reaches the final sheet. But the thing is that if I want to know how many worksheets I have, for example, please watch this. If I say view, and on view we have something called immediate window. The immediate window is basically used for debugging like this. For example, if I want to find out active workbook dot worksheets. Okay, so if you notice, I write active workbook.worksheets.count, and when I press enter, what does it do? It tells me there are 5 worksheets in my workbook, despite the fact that some are hidden and some are visible. So the immediate window is used for a few things, right? Let me show you. Please watch. If I write active workbook.worksheets like this and I say, NO is equal to this, right? Then I can say debug.print NO. When I run this, what will happen? That result will come here. If you're a non-programmer, then all of this might seem a little confusing and you must be thinking, why are we doing all this? But I hope you can still see the logic, right? It is a programming language. So codes at times will become very long. For example, look at these type of things, right? So these are long codes. And of course and this is not even one of the longer ones, but you get the idea. So of course you have to create breakpoints and do testing and do debugging and all of that. That is why we have what we call the debugging window, which is the immediate window. Good. So, tell me.
Small doubt. I'm not from program background. So, but I've done some. Why are you using debug.print here, not just print?
That is the nomenclature I have to follow. It's just the syntax. It's called debug.print. And like in TypeScript, we have console.log, right? So there's no reason for it. It's just what the language has. That's all, right? So just a minute. So like in TypeScript, you will have what we call a console. Anyway, I can't show it right now. That's okay. It's not important. All right, so we're getting somewhere. We know how many worksheets are there, right? So we can now go through these worksheets one by one. So the first thing I'll do is I will declare an object as a worksheet. So what will I say? I'll say dim WKS as worksheet. What is WKS? That is just a variable name. It could be anything. I could have written anything I wanted, okay? But usually we write it so that we know what it is. So I will say dim WKS as worksheet. Now, I know that my active workbook worksheets has many worksheets in it, right? So I want to go through all those worksheets one by one. So now I will say that for each WKS in my active workbook.worksheets, I want to perform an action. And what is an action? I will say WKS.visible is equal to Excel sheet visible, and then I will say next WKS. Let's just look at it like a simple business process, right? Not a business process, but a system process. We have declared an object, which is a worksheet, and we've given it a name called WKS. What are we doing then? We're saying that in my active workbook, there are numerous worksheets, maybe 5, maybe 50, maybe 500. So I want to go through every single of those worksheets inside my active workbook and change the visibility level to Excel sheet visible. And then I want to go to the second one. So basically it's a loop that I'm running. So it will keep on running the loop till I reach the final worksheet. Let's see how it works. So I will click on macros, unhide my sheets, click on run. Now see, I click, and in one click, you notice all the sheets have been unhidden. And even if I had like a very large number, let's say about 100 sheets. So I'm hiding 99 of them. Just a minute. Obviously doing it manually would be a big pain because you have to, if you unhide it, you have to do it one by one. What can we do now? Macros. Unhide my sheets, click on run, and you notice there is a little bit of a screen flicker, but it basically does it in, you know, like maybe a second or two. Right, questions, anyone?
Sir,
tell me.
just wanted to know, VBA has exception handling, or I actually don't remember about this, but is VBA has exception handling in built in it?
No, so I'll tell you what it has. So it has error handlers. So like, I'll just show you in the code window only. So for example, I can say on error go to like this, or I can say on error resume next, right? So that is what it has. Let me just quickly show you what the error handling looks like. Excel macro mastery. So we have these, okay? So we have on error go to, which means the error is shown. We have on error go to minus one, which is the default. If you want to ignore the error, you have on error resume next. This is like that except, right? Try except that you do on Python, similar to that.
Yeah. Got it, sir.
Then you have the error number, error description. So it's quite detailed. I mean, in terms of the error handling, I don't think you will feel that, oh, I wish it could have done something better. It will do it very well, right? You can also set breakpoints. Like you can just click here inside. Why is it not? Just a minute. Okay. You can just click here, and this is creating a breakpoint, right? Others can ignore this. This is for advanced testing and all. But those of you who know it, you know what I mean, right? So you can set up a breakpoint.
Sir.
So the code will only run till that certain point, right? So see, it's a good language. You have to understand that people have been using it for many years, and very complicated business models are built on it.
Sir, I have worked for a client who uses VBA in MS Access to create application.
Yeah, you can do that.
That will, to create an automation application using MS Access.
Yep, absolutely.
I was wondering, does VBA has that computational power to create to run those?
No. Even before you tell me what is the context, let me tell you it doesn't. VBA's computational power is pitiful. And that is one of the biggest disadvantages of VBA.
Because when we used to run the code, almost all the time the computer gets hanged. And
That's what I'm saying, right? Even before you told me what is the context, I told you no. Because VBA, remember, is not running on an independent IDE. It's running on Excel or on Access. It's very, very limited by, like, I have a highly spec laptop. I have a 2070 Supermax Q, 16 GB of RAM, 8 gigs of video memory. And VBA will still stutter for me. That is not a problem with the system. It's just the way the language works. It is not really meant for very large codes and very complex codes.
Yes.
Right. Great, guys. Now, gradually, let's go to another more practical example. What have we done? We have unhidden all the sheets, which is great. This is my requirement. I want to create a table of content, which means a list of all the sheets like this, 100 sheets with the name of that sheet. Right now, the name is sheet one, sheet two, sheet three. And I also want a hyperlink, okay? So what is the requirement? A new sheet will be created with a list of all the sheet names, one below the other, and there has to be a hyperlink for each of the sheets. Now imagine you did it manually. How would you do it? You will create a new sheet. Then you will say sheet two. Then you'll say sheet three like this. Then one by one, you will have to right click and then click on link and then select insert link. And then in the same document, you'll have to select that whatever sheet like this. Guys, VBA is going to do the same thing. Please understand, programming or macros or automation doesn't mean that it can do seven things at the same time.
Sir, we lost you for some time out there.
No problem. Is it okay now?
Yeah.
Okay. So what I was saying was that if I had to do something like this manually, I will first have to put in all the sheet names, one below the other. Then one by one, I'll have to right click, click on link, and then click on insert link, and then insert a link to that specific sheet. Now, a lot of people feel that, oh, if Havish is using VBA, it means that he will be able to put four links at the same time. I can't. Did we unhide all the sheets at the same time? No, we did not. We only did it one at a time. Please understand this. Again, computer programmers understand this concept. For others, this is very important. Macros can speed up the process. How? Because when I do it, I have to take 5 seconds for each sheet unhiding. When VBA does it, it does it so quickly that it seems that it's all happening instantaneously. But this is not a process where multiple sheets are being unhidden at the same time. That means if I say, can I put four links to four sheets at the same time? You will say, of course not. I'll have to do it one by one. If I ask you, can I put four links to four sheets using VBA? No, I can't. It can only do one at a time, but it can do it so fast that it will seem like it is happening instantaneously. Let's see how we do this. Now, I'll also teach you how to search for these codes on the internet. Anytime you want to search for a VBA code, and remember, there are hundreds, not hundreds, there are thousands of codes available. You just have to type VBA code 2, okay? And then whatever you want. Let's say I want to search for create table of content. So what is it doing? It is searching for a VBA code to create table of content. Let me open the first link that comes. It's a fantastic website, the Spreadsheet Guru. Now this code is going to be very long. Before I show you, let me warn you, it is quite a long code, but you don't need to bother with it because you just have to copy and paste it. Okay, but I will explain the code to you as well. This is the result what will be created like this. Let me copy the entire code. Come back and let's put it in a new module. So I will insert module 2 and we will paste the code here. Like I promised you, I will explain it, but let's first go back and see whether it is working or not. Very simple, click on macros. I have a macro called table of contents create. Click on run and see what happens. In one click, you get a list of all the sheet names along with a hyperlink to every sheet and a serial number and a title at the top. Right. Is there any question about what we were doing and what is the use case for doing this before I come to the actual code and explain you how it is working? Right. So I hope this is this is something that you would connect to, right? Like this is something we have to do all the time. Now, before we see the code, I want somebody like all of you to tell me, what do you think the process will be? What is the first thing that you think the code should do?
Count the number of sheets.
Even before that, what should it do? What is the sheet name? Contents? Isn't this a new sheet that is being created? So will I not say that create a new sheet called content? But I have a question. What if there was already a sheet called contents? Then what will happen? Then there might be an error because the VBA code will not know what to do. Isn't it possible that you already have a sheet called contents? And now when you tell VBA, run the macro, it says, but I don't know what to do with that one too. Should I overwrite it or not? So there has to be some check there. Fair enough. After that, of course, we will not, we don't really need to count all the sheets. Why do I need to? I just need to run a loop like we did with the unhiding. First, I will go to B1 and write table of content. I will put a underline, bold, font size 18. Okay. Then I'll have to put in all of these sheet names, which is nothing but the application worksheet name. But then a link also has to be put, remember? So this right click edit hyperlink, you notice that there is a link to the cell A1 in the sheet 1. So that is the link that we have to create. Now that we have done this, we don't actually need to create all this. Let's come to the code directly. Let's go over it one by one. We don't need to look at the declaration, let that be. The first thing is, I'm saying that my content name is equal to contents, right? The optimizing code I'll come to a little later, so just ignore that for now. In fact, let's do it one by one. Let's not skip anything. Optimizing code basically means that if you notice, everyone, when I ran the code, did you notice the screen did not flicker? You know, like in the unhiding, it went from one sheet to the other and it started to flicker very quickly. I'm not sure if it was clear in the video or not, but that is what happens. So what we can do is we can basically turn that off. Do you see this? Application.displayAlert false, application.screenUpdating false. For a moment, let me just turn it off, right? So I'm just going to comment it so that it will not run. Now let's see the code. Let me run it once again. Macros, table of content, create. This time what will happen is, do you notice that the screen stuttered for a while? You know, for that 1 or 2 seconds, it just stopped. And that is not a very good user experience. You know, think of it like a mobile app. When you click on a mobile app, if you, I don't know if any of you have Cred with you, but if you do have Cred with you, you should look at the way they've created an app. Beautiful, right? Why is one app better than the other one? Because of the user experience that you're creating. Because of the, not just the speed of the app, but the way there is a flow and continuity. That's the same thing that we want to do here. So how are we optimizing the code? We are telling the code that, see, before you run the code, make sure that Excel should not flicker and stop and pause because the user will not like it. But because you are optimizing the code, you're setting it off in the beginning. At the very end, you notice you also have to turn it on. Guys, this is very important. If you turn it off and you forget to turn it on, then it will permanently become off on your computer. Please, please pay a lot of attention to this. For example, if I write a shortcut in my code saying that Control C should be something else other than copy, and I forget to revert it back to Control C copy, what will happen? Going forward, you will not be able to use Control C for copy on your computer. This is almost like a registry change. This is why VBA is not available to normal users. You can crash your entire system using VBA. Like in VBA, there is a method called kill, which basically deletes files and folders. For example, if I say kill and I put the path of my folder and I run it accidentally, just imagine for a moment, right? Like I have my entire folder here, right? Let's say I have copied C directory and in my code, I simply write kill C directory like this in double quote and I click on run. There will be no prompt and it will be a permanent delete. You can't recover the data. So you have to be super, super, super careful. And I can't emphasize this enough when you're working with VBA. It's a full-fledged language. There is no safety net. You know that for beginners, it will not allow you to make these changes and all. And that's true for every language. Even in Python, you can do a lot of things on your system which you might not want to do. So please be very careful when you're working with VBA. Don't be in a hurry. See, with Excel, the worst thing that will happen is that your formula will not work, or maybe other formulas might get affected, but nothing else will happen, right? You can always close the file without saving it and reopen it. VBA is permanent changes like the kill, okay? All right, now let's see what we are doing. We have optimized the code. Then we are checking if the contents sheet is already there. Remember, this is very important. So I'm saying that worksheets contents activate. That means I'm assuming that a sheet called content is already there and I want to activate it. Fair enough. But I'm also putting on error resume next. That means that if the sheet wasn't there, then it should not throw an error for me. There are two pathways, right? So yes or no. If the sheet is there, go to the sheet. If the sheet is not there, proceed with the code, but don't give me an error saying, no, there isn't a sheet that I could find. Then we are saying if the active sheet.name is content name, which is basically nothing but contents, what do I want to do? Message box a worksheet. message box, my answer is message box, a worksheet named and content name has already been created. Would you like to replace it? This is very smart. Do you see this? This means that if I found a sheet called contents already there, I'm going to ask the user that, dude, there is a sheet called contents. What do you want to do? Do you want to replace it? Yes or no? Let me see it again. This time there is a sheet called contents, everyone. And let's say there's no data in it. It's just a blank sheet, but there is a sheet called contents. So when I run the macro, what will happen? It will now give me a prompt asking me that a worksheet named contents has already been created. What would you like to replace it? Yes or no? If I click on no, then the code will stop. It will not do anything. But if I click on yes, what will happen? It will give me the result. Right? So I'm saying select the sheet if it is there. And if it is there and the user says, yes, I want to write the sheet names on it, do that. So I'm checking what is the user saying, if the answer is yes or no. So what do I say? If my answer, this is a not equal to sign, okay? If my answer is not equal to yes, that means the user selected no, then I want to do something called exit sub. That means after this point, I will not run the rest of the code. I will just exit the sub. I will exit the subroutine. You know, like I tell you do 10 things, but if in the third step you find something wrong, don't do step number 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, correct? This is what I'm doing. If you find an error in step number 3, if the user selects no, don't do the rest. Don't do all this. But if the user has not selected no, he has selected yes, then what should happen? It should delete the old one because I don't know what data is there in the old one, right? So this entire thing is in my if end of. Fair enough. The rest is easy. I'm adding a worksheet because I have to create a blank worksheet. I'm changing the worksheet to the active worksheet. I'm changing the name to content. In B1, I'm writing table of contents. In B1, I'm making it bold. After that, this is a difficult part, but we have to take it up, okay? We are creating what you call an array. And this is a redim, which is a redimension. So this is an array that can change, which means that you can constantly expand it. So I'm saying that 1 to worksheet.count -1. Can anybody tell me why is it 1 to worksheet counts -1?
It should not count the content worksheet, right? We will create a new sheet called content. So
right.
So we need to remove it.
That's right. So what should happen is that it should count the number of worksheets, but it should not look at the content sheet, which is already there. But in any case, in a lot of codes, you will see this because the index position in VBA is mostly 0. See, if I've written 5 names, if the first one is an index position 0, then the last one will be 4. That means that if I count it, what will it be? It will be the last positional value plus 1 because my index position starts at 0, right? So do remember, this is also very important in programming. You always have to remember VBA index position 0. How should I show it to you? Just give me a moment. Okay, it's not loading. Let me just try once again. Anyway, that's okay. It's simple, right? Either I say that the first value is 1, the second is 2, the third is 3, or I say the first value is 0, the second is 1, the third is 2. Just be aware of that. Then what are we doing? We are saying we've already done this in unhiding. Remember, for each sheet in my active workbook or worksheets, last time, what were we doing? We were unhiding it. This time, what are we doing? We're saying if the sheet name is not equal to content name, then I want to make the sheet name come in what? Come in that array. So I'm creating a list of all the sheet names. Once I create a list, so this is what I'm doing, right? I'm creating an array list with all the sheet names, excluding content. Once I get a list of all the sheet names, I have to paste it somewhere. Where do I paste it? I paste it in the cell C3. All right. So if you notice, this part, I'm saying cells X plus 2, 3. What is X plus 2? It basically means X plus 2 and 3. So that means the third row and the third column, which is this C3. See, this is what will happen in coding. Like you will say, why couldn't they just write C3? But you don't do that. You can do it, by the way, but we don't do that because we are supposed to look at the spreadsheet like a grid. C3 is very difficult because that C is not a number, you know, so I can't look at a positional value. That is why you will always look at a positional value. Just to help you understand how many rows and columns I have, there is a logic to it. So if you notice, I have, just give me a moment. Haven't I put that? Okay, never mind. So if you notice, if I start writing numbers from 1 to 20,000, you will notice that we have 16,384 rows, columns with us. And what is the logic here? This is to the power of, sorry. To the power of 14. Now, you might ask me, but why is it 2 to the power of 14? I don't know. It just is, right? 2 to the power of 14 is the number of rows, number of columns that are there. So this is the number of columns. And then how many rows do we have? We have 1048576, which is to the power of, I don't know, 20? Yeah, 20, right? This is the number of rows that are there. Now, this is very important. I will never say in VBA that this is G11. What will I say? That this is the 11th row and it is the 7th column. Always the row comes first and the column comes later. In Excel, what is the problem? We write G11. We put the column first and then the row, but you know how it is, right? In a matrix, mathematically, we never do that. We always say the row comes first and then the column comes in. Okay. So what are we doing? We're basically putting that value. This is the link that we are putting. And then we are basically putting the list of all the sheets one by one. We are doing an auto fit so that the width of the column expands. And this is optional, this part. This is nothing but the other things, you know, like this blue color and serial number and all of that. So this is the interior color, vertical alignment, things like these. And at the end, I'm also doing an active window.zoom 130. That means the zoom level of the screen will automatically be set to 130, which is very cool. Like I can set it to 150. And now watch, if I run the code once again, when the code gets executed, you notice the zoom level is automatically set to 150. Do you all see the level of control I have on my Excel application using VBA? You know, even things like this, the zoom level, whether the ribbon is enabled or not, not just the cell and the formula and the formatting. I can control everything on my application using VBA. Obviously, I can't change this using a formula, correct? If I have to change it, I have to put in a number manually. But I can now change it using a formula, right? Great. Any questions on this? Now, I want to do one more example with you. All okay.
Sir, what are more common examples of using VBA in general day-to-day life?
It's not like that. VBA is automation. Whatever business process an organization has, that is what we are trying to automate, right? So it's not that there are ready-made common examples for VBA. It is never like that. See, anything which is a common task, it is already available on the tab. You can, in any case, click on a button and do it. For example, let me ask you. Let's write three names. How do I make it uppercase? Guys, how do I make it uppercase? Tell me what to do.
Near the that tab, size tab, there is an option.
Where is the option? I don't know of an option. Where is the option? There is no option in Excel to change it to uppercase. There is an option in Microsoft Word, and there is an option
PowerPoint.
Correct? Havish, I can go to case and I can make it uppercase. Same thing I can do on PowerPoint. For some strange reason, Excel doesn't have this option, right? So Excel doesn't give you the ability to make it uppercase. So how do you do it? Tell me quickly.
You have a formula.
Tell me. What do I do?
It's equal to uppercase.
So first step, I will have to write a formula.
Yeah.
Second step, I'll have to drag it down. Third step, I'll have to copy the results. Fourth step, I'll have to paste it as a value. Fifth step, I'll have to delete the formula. For such a simple task, how many steps did we take? 5 steps, correct? And this is what organizations want to automate. Because when 15 people are doing 15 such things and they're spending an extra 15 seconds 100 times a day, you can imagine how many hours, man hours it costs. So how do we solve it? Please watch. What have I done? I have created a VBA code where I can select the data. Formulas, uppercase. Like you have it on Word and PowerPoint, I've created one on Excel. One click, uppercase, one case, one click, lowercase, right? That is the practical use of uppercase. Like when I get a data set, when you guys get a data set, what do? You have to, let's say you have 1,000 names with you. You will make a column, you will write an upper, drag the formula down, copy the value, put it back. It's not difficult, but it is time consuming, right? And why should you do the same thing over and over and over again? Isn't mine simpler? Isn't this approach so much simpler than that? Let's look at one more. Let's say that you have just a moment. Okay. So I have Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, and I've written the year. Let me make all of these the same width. How do you put year in the center?
Sir, merge and center.
But what is the problem? The problem is that if I put it in the merge and center, right? Let me put a border also. Can I put a filter on this?
No.
Because if you try to put a filter, it will only come as one filter, correct? Also, if I try to press Control Spacebar to select column D, it will not select it because it will select all the four. But if I don't merge and center it, it will not look good because if I present the data like this, even with a border, I'm sure you will agree that it doesn't look good. What is the solution? Select. Please watch. Select. Havisham Consulting. Formatting. Center across selection. I'm not merging the cells, but whatever text I've written, I'm putting that text in the center of my selection. So see what happens. It looks as if it's merge and center, but these cells are still separate. And if you notice, I can now put a filter. Now, this is, hold on. This is not something which is not supported in Excel. If it wasn't supported, then how could I have done it? You can do it manually also. You can go to alignment, then you can go to horizontal alignment, and you can select center across selection like this. What have I done? I have made this process a little simpler for you to do by clicking on a single button. EY and PwC have two add-ins that they use, macros that they have created, a list of macros. EY has something called Toolbox and PwC has something called Smart. What is it? It is a tab like this. Like I have Havisham Consulting, they have Toolbox and Smart. And their global team has created different macros for them, which will help the user save a lot of time and, you know, do tasks that either is very difficult on Excel, very time consuming or error prone, or maybe not possible at all, right? For example, let me show you something very special. All of this is okay. Let's look at something really cool. I have two sheets. One is my input and the other is my output, okay? And I'm going to color this green so that you know that this is the output sheet and this is my input. So I'm going to color this yellow. I have three numbers here, 1, 2, 3. And I want to get the sum of these numbers in this cell. How will you do it? Now, usually you will say, we will write equal to sum. Then you will go to the other sheet and you will select the data, correct? But I can't view two different sheets at the same time, can I? Like I can only click on one sheet, right? How can I see two different sheets at the same time on one computer, on one monitor? So please watch. Avishram Consulting, navigation, and I have something called split screen. What does it do? When you click on that button, it will make two copies of your Excel file. So on one side, you can have the input, and on one side, you can have the output. Isn't this cool? Like, can you imagine how much time and effort this can save for users who are working on complicated financial models and, you know, they want to have two sheets for comparison or to write a formula. So you write it. Once you're happy with the result, how do you rejoin it? Just click on join and it will combine it into a single Excel. Now, these, of course, are fairly complicated macros. These are not macros, you know, I haven't recorded it. I've written everything. And these are products that I sell to different companies, right? But the reason I'm showing you different things is to show you that VBA is not just one thing. It is capable of a lot of other things, right? Before you ask your questions, and if you have any observations, let me just show you a few more things. Like if I have AB 123, 12, BN 45, like this, and like this. Let's say I want to separate the number. Okay, this has come from my bank statement. And the problem is that my transaction amount is mixed with some random characters like this. How do you separate the number in Excel? What formula will you write? Is there any formula that can separate the numerical component from a number? There isn't. The short answer is, there is no function in Excel that can understand what is numerical and what is text. So what have I done? I have created my own function called extract number. Okay, how does it work? Simply select the input and it will only extract the number for you. Even better. Now you get your amount, but you want to show it as a currency. How do we do that? Now I'll write convert to INR and it will convert it into a currency. So this is how we can even add our own custom functions to VBA. Like everything is a function, right? When I say equal to VLOOKUP or equal to index or equal to whatever XLOOKUP or equal to sum, these are all functions that are inbuilt. But I can also create my own function. If you notice, I've created my own functions on Excel like this. And this is the example I want to cover for you, a simple one. And obviously this will be there in the file as well. So you can go back and practice. Let's say we have the data for previous year and we have the current year and some numbers are there. Can somebody tell me how do you find out the YOY change? What is the YOY change? How do you find out?
Final minus initial by initial into 100.
Absolutely. So you will say equal to current year minus previous year divided by previous year, right? And once you get all this, you will convert this into a percentage, right? But you still have to write the formula, isn't it? What if I want to create a function called change, right? Like right now, there's a function called change, or let's call it YOY change, right? So I'm going to create a function called YOY change in which I want to select PY, CY, and it will automatically give me the same result. Let's see how. So we will insert a new module. And earlier we were creating a subroutine, which means that I have to click on the run button to execute it. But this time I want to create a function, which is what we call a UDF, or what is a user defined function, right? You can do this on every language, even on Python and R and all of that. So we want to write this function and I want to call it YOY change. Like a routine starts with sub and ends with end sub. This starts with the function and ends with end function, right? Now, the difference here is that I have to take two inputs from the user, the current year and the previous year. So what will I say? I will say that the current year, okay, as an integer, and my previous year as an integer. And what is the formula that we want to write? We'll say that my YY change is equal to my CY minus my PY divided by PY. Let me change it to capital PY. Now let's see what will happen. Rather than writing this, I can now write equal to YY change, PY, comma CY, and you get the result. Wait a second. Oh, CY and PY, right? Yeah, so the order should be reverse. B2 and A2, and you get the result. Right. Now, with this specific example, you might say, really, like you must have saved like 5 seconds of work. But you understand the scalability, right? Like if somebody is writing a complex formula in an organization, you have 10 people working in a function. One person is very good with Excel, and this guy loves to write these complex formulas and get the correct result. What about the other 9 people who have to catch up with that person? Then this one person has to teach the others, or the other persons have to upskill themselves. Errors will happen, issues will come. But we know what is the expected outcome. Isn't it easier to tell somebody that no, rather than writing a complex formula every single time, tomorrow a new employee will join, you will have to do a knowledge transfer. Isn't it easier to simply say, forget what to do. I'm telling you there is a function called YY change. You just select the current year and the previous year. It will do the calculation for you. In this case, you knew how to calculate the current year, previous year, YY change. So you could have done it. But what about a case like this? One more example, final one.
Sir,
please tell me.
Sir, while writing in Excel, when we start writing the function, it gives the like tooltip. Variable one, variable two.
This thing, right? You mean this, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, arguments do not come with UDF. So when you write a UDF, please watch. Like when I write HMC YY change, right? You notice that the arguments pop-up will not come. That is a problem because this is a user-defined function. This prompt, you know, this description, these different paths that you have to fill, that will not come with the UDF.
Okay, sir.
That's a limitation of how it works. What you can do is you can type YY change and then click on the FX button, this one. And this will basically ask you whether CY and PY like this, which is okay. It's not the best, but it's still better than having nothing, right? Let's say an employee joined on the 1st of January and he did not like, or whatever, he was fired on the 23rd of October. The organization wants to know days worked. Okay. How do you do that? And we know there were 5 public holidays. That part we know. Okay. Which is easy. It's a calendar, so you can reduce 5. But how do you know the number of days worked? Anyone? See, will this be correct? Equal to minus this 296? Not really. Because if he has worked as per a 5-day work week, then what do we have to reduce from this 296? Employee joined on 1st, was sacked on the 23rd, which was his relieving date. The organization wants to give him a compensation as per the number of days that person worked. But you count a 5-day work week. When I do 23rd October minus 1st January, it comes as 296. Why is this incorrect? Guys?
Because it calculates a 7-day work week.
Saturday and Sunday is also being calculated. This is the calendar difference, correct? Actually, it should be plus 1 because you want to count the first day as well. From this, the number of Saturdays and Sundays have to be removed. How do you do that? How do you remove the weekends? You can't. There is nothing on Excel that allows you to count the number of weekends. There just isn't, right? What we have to do is we have to first say equal to, please watch, net work days, where I have to take the start date and the end date, right? And this will give me the number of weekends, sorry, the number of working days, which is 213, like this. Now, imagine you wanted to count the number of weekends. Let's just spin the question a little bit. How many weekends were there? So what will you do? You will write first the difference, calendar difference, minus the number of working days. And what will this give you? This will give you everyone the number of, let me just write the formula here. So what are we doing? B7, B16 plus one is giving me the total number of days. Network days is giving me the net number of working days. And what is 84? The subtraction, it gives me the number of weekends. Isn't this very complicated? And this is a very common HR requirement, okay? Because what happens is a person comes to you and he asks for whatever, a salary or a raise or something. And then you have to say, no, but you have had so many weekends in this period. Let's say there is a project schedule, or you have to bill the client, or you have to plan your resource allocation. Would you not want to know how many weekends are going to fall in that period? Let's say it's a 1.5 year schedule. You want a precise number, 54 or 55 or 57. This is what you have to write. It's not very easy. A lot of people don't even know the function network days. Plus you have to accommodate this plus one and then write everything. You know what I've done? Please watch. I've created a simple way of calculating the same result, equal to HMC weekends, select the start date, select the end date, and you get the same result. Do you see the advantage now? I have reduced this into this. And don't look at the function name. The function name is HMC date weekends, but actually the formula is only this. The function is only B16, B17. So rather than writing B17 minus B16 plus one minus network days B16, B17, I can simply write the function. Like I can say, let's say I'm working with your institute. So what can I say? I can say XIMB B16 comma B17. That's it. Right now, the question is how many people create these functions? Very few. The thing is that this is fairly complicated work, and this is hardcore programming, core programming. But you also need to have a very good understanding of how Excel works to be able to do all this. So if you look at it like a Venn diagram, if you look at all the people who are advanced Excel users who need it and who work on it, and if you create another circle with all the people who know programming, and if you look at the commonality, it's very small. Very few Excel advanced users do programming, and very few programmers know Excel. You tell me, like somebody who did a BTEC CSE and went to become a data analyst or whatever it is, MSc, will they know how to work on Excel? They will not have the first clue about it. It's not that they can't, it's just that they don't have that background, and you can't just learn Excel in one day. Excel is acquired learning. To really understand how Excel works, you have to spend years and years with case studies and use cases and all of that, right? So that is what VBA offers you, the opportunity to do things on Excel, which will make your manager sit up and say, you're amazing. If you only learn tips and tricks and, you know, somebody asked me for shortcuts, there is only so much that you can improve yourself. You can maybe go one notch or two notches higher, but there is a ceiling. You can't cross that. If you want to cross that, then you have to get into programming, because this is the correct formula. I can't make this formula any smaller. Guys, this is what it is. Like, if I have to calculate the number of weekends, I have no other choice. This is the only choice I have. Like, this is the most efficient way of calculating the number of weekends, which is what I have always been doing. But imagine if I show this to a client, how much it will help them, because they don't have to teach people how to start doing all this, right? So we have done a function as well. We have done routine. I don't want to do the recording today because it will take some time. We will do it in the next session, in the first quarter of the session, and we'll do that patiently. But good, I hope you're starting to see what all it is that VBA is capable of.
So one small question.
Tell.
So whatever user-defined formulas which you have made, so is it available system-wide or is it limited to only this Excel sheet?
Very, very good question. So what is happening is that the function that we are writing, okay, is only available on the current Excel. But right now you notice my function will work on every single Excel file. How is that working? Because I have created a tab from it. So this is what is called an add-in, right? So let's just quickly see this. So these are called Excel add-ins. You know what is the best example of an Excel add-in? Something that all of you guys would have already seen earlier. I'm sure all of you have worked on the solver. What is solver? It's an add-in. The solver is not made by Microsoft. It is made by some other company. Similarly, if you look at the data analysis toolpath, this is also an add-in made by somebody else, right? Which is a statistical package. So these are additional capabilities that are available on Excel. This is available system-wide, but if we go to my example, our example, which is this one, the two macros that we created. You know, this system name, table of content, unhide. This will not be available on other workbooks because you have saved it in the current file. But how do you use it on other files? Let's say I have a new workbook. And here also I want to create a table of content, right? Please watch. When I click on developer and macros, you will notice that I can access the macros from other workbooks. So it is saying that I can run that macro called table of contents create even on this workbook. So I can click on run and it runs it here. But obviously to be able to do this, the other file has to be open. Now you might say, but you know what, that's not the best way of doing it because I will have to open that file before I run it on a different workbook. Can we not do something so that the macro is available on all the workbooks? You can, but I would strongly advise you not to do it because there is a lot of risk involved in it. And I'll tell you the reason why. Right now, this is a controlled environment. If something goes wrong with my code, it is restricted to my current Excel, okay? So even if something goes wrong, I can delete it and start afresh. The moment you say that my code can access every single Excel file, then it becomes very dangerous because anybody can do anything they want. I mean, anybody in the sense that, of course, you will be working, but even if you accidentally run it without realizing it, it might do something. And everyone, please remember, a macro cannot be undone. Whatever a macro does, whatever result it creates, you cannot press Control Z. That means if I write 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then I run a macro, okay? What is this? What am I creating? This is what we call a stack. So every time I press Control Z, what am I doing? I'm going one level up in that stack. See, if I press Control Z, what am I doing? I'm removing the text, the color, and then one by one, I'm removing everything. Right? Please watch. Now what's going to happen is that the moment I run a macro, system name, run. Now I press Control Z. Right now it is working. Fair enough. But if the macro put in a value in one of my cells, then what will happen? My undo stack will not work. That means after I run the macro, I will not be able to press Control Z, which is again a very big limitation that you have to keep in mind. You know, we as users have become so not even used to, I would say, we just assume that Control Z, how can an application not have Control Z? Like how can an application not give me the ability of going back? But you have to understand that in programming, you don't have Control Z. If you do something and something goes wrong, it goes wrong. The only thing you can do is you can make sure to not make that same mistake again, right? Because you'll have to rerun the entire process. There is no concept of an undo, right? That is something that these softwares have made us so comfortable with that we just assume that whenever we are working, we just press Control Z and it just magically works. It doesn't work so in programming. Let's take a small example. I want you to see how it works. Let me create a small subroutine called bold, right? And we will say, just a minute, let me just. Okay. So we'll say selection dot font dot bold is equal to true. All right. Let's run this. Now, right now you notice my control Z is working perfectly. I want to select stack and I want to click on macro and I want to run bold run. Now see, when I press control Z, nothing is happening. Your entire undo stack has been removed from memory. It doesn't remember anything. And you have to be very, very careful about this. So this is called a VBA undo stack, right? Now I know some people will ask questions like, how can you save the undo stack? But don't bother searching, you can't, right? There is no undo button when you're working with VBA. I know all of this says you can preserve it, but that only works with specific tasks that you're performing. That also is a very complicated way of doing it. You have to create some class modules and all. The short answer is you will not be able to do it. Right. Let me show you. See, these are areas where as a programmer, I have spent, I don't know, 250, 300 hours of work over the last 3 years, studying and reading and going to forums and understanding, looking at what people have been doing, right? So anyway, I can't just show you what it is, but the basic idea is that it doesn't have an undo stack, right? It removes the undo stack. Good. Yeah, I think that's good for today. So we have seen VBA is an old language. It is not the same as VB. Support stopped in 2008, but Microsoft still comes up with updates. Like if a new feature comes in, that feature is also rolled out in VBA. So it's not truly legacy. It is still supported and it will be supported for many, many years to come. I've given you a glimpse of what TypeScript is. TypeScript and VBA are meant for the same thing, but they have nothing in common, nothing. The language is different. The objects are different. Everything is different. It doesn't, like if you place it left and right with the same task that it is performing, there will be no similarity, right? So just think of it as learning something completely new. Learning VBA will not really help you much when it comes to learning TypeScript. Learning Excel will help you with both because you understand the flow and the process, but one language will not help you with the other one. They are so different. Then we wrote subroutines and functions. I also showed you, you can search for these things online. There are thousands of such codes available. We did an example with the table of content. I mentioned that like a good programming language, you can have breakpoint, debug, error handling, and all of that. The computational power is very, very small. So don't expect it to do very complex tasks. It will crash. Of course, you can make it efficient, but there is only so much you can do about it. Then I showed, obviously, the macro will be saved in a Excel SM, which is a macro enabled workbook. VBA doesn't work on the cloud. And what else? Yeah, and I've shown you the code. Now remember, in VBA, these spaces don't mean anything. Okay, I can have as many spaces as I want. This is not like Python. Okay, in Python, white space means something, correct? In VBA, it doesn't mean anything. You can remove the space also, or put it on the same line. It will be the same thing. Whether you like it or dislike it, I will not comment on that, but it is what it is, right? So a lot of people say, like a lot of people prefer Python because Python white spacing makes you write a code properly. In VBA, the problem is that if you don't put these indents properly, it will look very, how should I put it? Look at this. Let me just show you the entire code without any white space. Do you see how much more complicated it looks now? The good thing is you don't have to bother with the white space. The bad thing is that if you don't put the white space, then the code becomes very difficult to understand. Like here, the comments are there. If the comments were not there, it would have become even more difficult. I also showed you UDF, which is user-defined functions. Yes, we have user-defined function in Excel VBA, and you can do a variety of tasks with it. So basically, you can overcome the limitations or the lack of features that Excel has. Great. That will be all for today. We will continue on Saturday. We have a one-day break. Anything you would like to ask? So don't worry. I know it seems very overwhelming and it seems very dry when you look at VBA in the beginning, but let me, you know, instill a little bit of excitement in you to show you what we'll be doing next time. In the next lecture, I'll be showing you how using VBA, you can do things like this. I'll show you two examples. Look at this. This still opening. This entire survey form has been made on Excel. Do you see this? There are different paths. There are different buttons that I can click on. There are different types of list box, combo box, text boxes, all of this. And everything is working on VBA. So this is what we call a user form. So you can create a form like this. Give you one more example.
Sir, I was going to ask about this. In MS Access also, we create user forms.
It's much easier. See, I'll tell you, the point with MS Access, guys, is that MS Access is not a tool for non-IT guys. It's meant for IT professionals, right? You need to know SQL. You need to understand databases. Access is a fantastic tool. But Access is not a tool that an Excel user can suddenly switch over to. Like, you tell me, out of the whatever number of people are there are 15 of us, how many of you have worked on Access? You guys have a little bit of work experience? None of you. If you ask at XIMB, how many students have ever worked on Access in their life? No one, maybe one or two people. The problem with Access is it's a IT tool. It's not a tool for everyone, unlike Excel, right? So like, these are the type of forms that
sir, these user forms will act as a desktop applications, right? I mean,
no, this is running on top of Excel. You will have to open Excel to make it run. It cannot run like it is running on top of an Excel file, not as an exe file or as an application. That would not be possible. You're not creating software, okay? You are basically creating a form on top of Excel.
Yes, sir.
Like, there is some creativity that you can do. Like, you can hide the Excel so that to the user it seems that it is running like an application, but the file will still be an Excel file. It cannot become anything else. See, these are, I'll tell you. So there are basically, you can, if you ask this question, convert Excel into exe. This again is a common question. So there's something called Excel compiler, which basically allows you to convert your Excel files into an executable exe, right? Like this. So you can Google all this, but this would require a little bit of development work. Like this is a application which you can just download and it will convert it into an exe, right? Excel to exe.com. Then you also have something called advanced installer. This is one of the best tools for creating applications and even like full-fledged application. Let me show you. So their architect license is $3,600, right? It's a one-time perpetual license. It's fairly expensive. If you're curious, then you can read it. Otherwise, you can skip all this, everyone. See, it's good to know. That's what I'm saying, you know? Like, you guys ask me questions and how is it that I'm able to give you these answers? This is not what I do. I'm a data analyst, okay? My job is not to create applications and do development work and all of that. But it's good to know, because when you're working on a project, even as a data analyst, you will be working in a team, okay, where you have different aspects of a project. You can't say that, see guys, you can't say to the client that, I'm sorry, but I can only do the statistical analysis and create a dashboard. I know nothing of all of this. Is that the answer that you want to give to somebody? Of course not. You know, you want to be able to be a part of these conversations, right? Am I an expert? Of course not. But at least I know what to search for, right? I don't have to randomly go, like, a lot of time I see people go on Google and they search and they don't even know what they expect. I know what to expect because I've already searched for these things in the past. So just because I'm showing you many things, don't get overwhelmed thinking, oh, it's too much information. It's never too much information. Learn to prioritize. If something is not on priority for you, put it in the back of your head as a lesser priority. Right? Great. Good. What else? So next session, we will do macro recording and user forms. We will spend maybe 30, 40 minutes on it, and then we will work on Tableau. Tableau will be much simpler now because we've already worked on Power BI. We've spent a lot of time on it, so you'll find it much simpler. Great. That's all from my side. If you have any questions, I'm here.
Sir, one more question. Yeah. You have created this application in Excel, right? These application are can we link this application to web scraping, like we do in RPA? We can't link it, right?
No. What have I created? When you said I have created something,
The application that you have shown.
It's not an application, it's the user form, right?
Yeah, user form.
See, we have, you know Selenium? Do you know Selenium?
Testing.
Yeah. So Selenium is there for VBA also, right? But this is very limited in scope. So Selenium can also be used for web scraping, right? It's not just for testing. So for scraping of information from web pages. So you can use Selenium, like if you notice here, you can basically enable the Selenium library and then you can scrape information. But it would not really be very helpful because tools like Power Query and all are already there. They're much better at it. Plus VBA has a bandwidth issue. So, I mean, no company for a proper project will ever be using VBA for web scraping. Like if you're really desperate, I guess you can, but it is more of an academic project than an actual business project. No company is investing time in web scraping using VBA. Right? But you can just maybe Google it. Just type VBA Selenium and you will get some ideas. Right? Like if you notice here, I'm basically going to my website, right? .php, and then I'm reading the data from there, from all the tags, the element tag, and then I'm populating a list from an array. So it's possible, but it's not the best because it hasn't been updated at all for so many years.
So these forms are used for standalone any input of data like this, right?
What do you mean when you say standalone?
You have information with you and you are inputting something into the Excel, or you are...
See, it can do both. It can fetch data from the internet, which is scraping, or it can push data into a website, right? Two things, right? Like I can either pull the data or I can push the data. So it can do both of it. But again, these things will be so much easier using Python. Like if you use Beautiful Soup, for example, this is dead simple, right? So it is a little, like I would never, even me with so much experience on VBA, I would never even attempt to do all this on VBA because it doesn't make any sense whatsoever when there are so many better ways of doing it. See, just because it's there doesn't mean you should do it, right? That's how I'll put it. Don't invest your time in this. It's it's not going to lead you to any positive dividends, I can guarantee. If you were doing this 10 years back, yes, you would have had a little bit of a upper edge compared to other peers in the industry. Today, if you tell somebody, I know how to do Selenium and VBA, they'll be like, why? I mean, they will not say, what do you know? They will say, why do you know this? It's not helpful at all. Right? See, I'm just giving you a perspective. Like, I'm not trying to dissuade you or anything, but I'm just trying to save you a lot of time because it won't help you. It's not a skill that you can add to your resume.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Great. Anything else? Anyone? All right, then. So thank you. We will meet on Saturday evening. Usually that statement is a very different context, but anyway. So we'll have a next session on Saturday. And again, one more time, please don't be too overwhelmed. I know it seems like a lot because it is programming. If any of you have learned Python, you know how it is, right? Whenever you learn a new programming language, it seems like this, but this is super important. You have to learn a little bit of it. So that's okay. Take all the time in the world that you want. It's not that you have to learn it now or in a month. Spend a couple of years on it. I've been doing this for 5 years now, 5-6 years now, right? And I started very slowly. What I recommend is that if you want to speed things up, please purchase this book, Dummy's Guide to VBA. I don't know how expensive it is, but it's a little expensive, but maybe you can get a PDF or something, right? Excel VBA Programming for Dummies. It's a good book. It's the entire Dummies series is very nice. It's completely to the point. They don't give you a lot of background literature and all. They just tell you exactly what you need to know. And this guy, John Walkenbach, is also the guy who has written the Excel Bible, which is called the Excel 2019 Bible. He's again one of the leading Excel developers in the world. Right? And we are friends. So, I mean, we're not friends, but like we are connected on LinkedIn. So whenever I have a problem, I reach out to him and he gives me an answer. Great. All right then. So I will be uploading the lecture and also the file. So if you have some time, please at least open it and sort of recap what all we have done. And we'll continue it on Saturday. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.